Hi everybody, and welcome to this talk on system efficiency within industrial refrigeration. My name is Anders Olsen, and with me today I have Thomas Lund, global application expert. Thomas has more than 24 years of experience working within industrial refrigeration. And Thomas, you have written this paper on system efficiency within industrial refrigeration. Can you tell us a little bit more about why you wrote this paper?
Yes, we can. Our background for doing the calculations in the first place was that we see a lot of claims in the press and the literature and on the net regarding the efficiency of these refrigeration systems. And quite frankly, a lot of them surprise us quite a lot with the result that people come out with. It is because there is a lot of prerequisites that you make for the background for your calculations. What you choose to calculate, it matters quite a lot to the result. So we thought, as Danfoss, we have a lake in every camp, so we were able to provide a balanced and neutral calculations to show how we think that the reality is with regards to the efficiency.
So can you tell us a little bit more about how you managed to level the playing field here?
Yeah, we decided that we could have looked at a lot of existing systems, but they would most likely be very colored by whoever built them. So we wanted to do it as calculations, and at the same time we also wanted to have what we call a rule-based selection of components. Meaning that all of the components in the system were sized according to the same rules. So it was not like one system had a bigger condenser than other systems, which would be an advantage. They had something that was sized according to the same rules, and therefore they were as equal as we think we can make them. In a few cases, there was something that we felt that we had to make some adjustments from one system to another, or one refrigerant to another. For instance, CO2 is very mild when it comes to pressure loss, and the resulting downsides to that pressure loss. So we gave CO2 that benefit in the calculations, and we put a little penalty on the ammonia side. But we have outlined all our calculations and all our choices in the paper that we presented at the 2019 IIR conference in Montreal. So you can get it from there and see what it is and redo the calculations or change our prerequisites to what you think is more appropriate to you.
Sounds very good. Can you tell us more about the systems and the conditions under which the calculations were made?
Yeah. We started out saying that we wanted to model systems that had two temperature levels, and we decided with a -2 degree air temperature and at the medium temperature, and a -25 at the low temperature. The evaporating temperature comes from this air temperature, but there's a difference in temperature difference from DX to flooded system, so that gave us some differences. We decided to model 5 different systems, CO2 transcritical in a DX operation mode, a CO2 transcritical in flooded or pumped version, a two-stage ammonia system, pumped operation as it normal is in ammonia, a CO2 and an ammonia cascade, again with pumped. And finally, for sort of a backwards comparison purposes, a two-stage R507, also with pumped. All of the systems we calculated in what we call a simple version, which would be sort of a bare bone system type, basically the cheapest that you could find and install, but also an optimized version where we had basically all the bells and whistles that we could put into it to have the highest efficiency of the system. We also calculated in 4 different sizes. From relatively small, 50 kilowatts on the low temperature and 150 on the medium temperature. We kept that 3-to-1 ratio all the way up to the large system, which was 900 at low temperature and 2700 at medium temperature. As it was, we found that there was no difference, significant difference from the size of the system. So we skipped that in the last half, so we could do a little bit less work and focus a little bit more on the results. Mm. We also chose to calculate in three different locations, cold locations where we chose Oslo, a medium temperature where we chose Frankfurt, and a hot location where we chose Rome. We know that if you are from Australia or Asia or Middle East, then Rome is not particularly hot. But it was hot enough for us to show the trend that we needed to show, so we stick with that. Finally, we did some calculations to evaluate some of the choices we made. For instance, we were running at constant capacity all the time, and we did some calculations to reveal if that helped some of the systems more than others, and it did. So but you can see that in the paper. So we did some evaluation of how well we thought our calculations represent the real world.
So. Yeah, very interesting, Thomas. Looking at the results from this, from all these calculations, was there a clear conclusion?
The clear conclusion is that ammonia two-stage is always the most efficient. However, it's not always that simple. The CO2 transcritical in cold climates, particularly, and also in the medium temperature climate, comes relatively close in efficiency in the optimized versions. While when we go to the hot climates, even though Rome was not that hot, we could still see that the transcritical system started lagging behind in efficiency. It's well known that CO2 gets into trouble when the ambient is high, and now we quantified it in these calculations. The cascade system was not as good as we initially thought, but when we thought a little bit about it, it was because the cascade was sort of out of its depth. It was not cold enough for a cascade to be efficient. So had you gone to say minus 40 or minus 50 on the low temperature, the cascade would have been the definite choice. The 507 two-stage was a little bit behind, but that was what we expected to see. So. Of course, there's a lot of other things that you need to consider when you choose a refrigerant and a system type.
What kind of aspects could it be that you have to consider?
It's very normal on ammonia systems to run with evaporative condensers, but evaporative condensers have a very high consumption of water. And you need to put in chemicals to for the water treatment, and whenever you need to change the water because it's simply too dirty and too foul, then you need to pay to get rid of it. So you have some very significant costs involved with an evaporative condenser. The CO2 systems run either with a dry cooler that does give you a bit of a penalty with regards to efficiency, but they use very often adiabatic coolers, which also use water but use a lot less water. They don't use water treatment. They do have a cost of these mats that you need to change, but in general they seem to be at a very lower cost on the water side of condensing / gas cooling. Furthermore, there has been a lot of governmental focus on ammonia these years, and particularly with respect to the charge size, the amount of ammonia that you have, and especially in densely populated areas. That gives you quite a high workload workload, time, and money that you need to spend on keeping the the government happy about the safety of your system.
Is that because ammonia is dangerous?
Well, the sad truth is that there's not a substance on this planet that cannot kill you. If it's oxygen, it's highly flammable. If it's not oxygen, it can, as a minimum, suffocate you. Ammonia is toxic, you could say that the benefit of ammonia is that you can smell it very, very rapidly before it gets dangerous, so you are out of there. But it is toxic, and it is flammable in a very narrow band of concentration. Many of the other refrigerants have been very successful at telling the story that their refrigerant is oh so safe and fantastic. But not least the CO2 guys. But you have to remember that CO2 is used in slaughterhouses to kill pigs. So CO2 kills you in another way than ammonia does, but it can kill you. And if you look at the fatalities, we had fatalities with ammonia systems, but they are in systems. Or you could say that 99% of all the systems with ammonia is in relatively large factories. So you have a large system, or you have a large charge, and a high concentration of refrigerant compared to the area that you have. Whereas most of the CO2 systems we have is supermarkets, where you have a modest charge to a very, very large area. So the concentration is different, and it's my personal opinion that if we replaced all the ammonia systems with CO2 systems, then people would start dying from CO2. The point is that everything is dangerous, but we have electricity that can kill us today. We deal with it with good engineering. We drive down the motorway with 120 kilometers per hour and 60 liters of highly flammable liquid just behind our seats. We deal with it, it's safe. And we jump into the ocean with 200 bars in a tank on our back. It's dangerous, but we deal with it, so it's safe. So it's a matter of engineering to get past all these dangers. Yeah.
Thanks, Thomas. It's time to wrap up here. Is there something we can conclude on basis of this paper?
Yeah, if you are looking at efficiency only, or you are in a situation where you can go efficiency only, then you should go ammonia, definitely. If you are in a situation to do, for instance, a mall, then I would probably not put ammonia out in a mall in a place where there's thousands of people. In that case, I would probably go with a CO2 or another solution. So it depends on the situation. If you only look on the ammonia, then it's the most efficient. But there are other choices. So I think there's room for every player in this field.
Thank you very much, Thomas, for your insights.
You're welcome.
And thank you, everybody, for joining these sessions. There will be a Q&A session right after here. You will have the link for the Q&A session in your chat. And if you have any questions, just click the link and you will be with us in the Q&A session. But otherwise, I would say thank you for joining in and have a great day, everybody.